Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the University of the Witwatersrand's Fossil Hominid Vault here in Johannesburg, South Africa. I'm Lee Berger, a paleoanthropologist here at the university and an explorer at large for the National Geographic Society. Today, we're going to look at an extremely difficult question, one that may not have a satisfactory answer. And that is, how many species of extinct hominid are found at the fossil sites of Sterkfontein, Taung, Makapansgat, and Gladysvale? Why is this so difficult? Well, it's due to the nature of the fossil record, and it's due to how we as paleoanthropologists attempt to determine what is a species and what's not, and how much variation is allowed within a species. There are probably six fossil samples from Africa that pose a particular problem for paleoanthropology regarding whether they represent as a whole a single species. Or are they actually an amalgamation of more than one species into a grouping based on historical factors, the nature of the fossil record itself and being inadequate to test the single species question, or simply the natural desire to make some sense out of a complex fossil record? These samples are Australopithecus africanus, Paranthropus robustus, Paranthropus boisei, Homo habilis, Australopithecus afarensis, and Homo erectus. Each of these species shares a similarity in being defined accumulatively. That is, initially discoveries were made and then fossils were added to the hypodon, often not on their morphology, but on their place of discovery and perceived age of the fossils. While each species mentioned above has a different historical origin, and thus its own set of complexities, they share the fact that for much of the history of modern paleoanthropology, the period in which at least three of them were described, they suffered under the shadow of three hypotheses that have now largely been proven false. The first is that only a single species of hominid within a broad adaptive role would exist in any one geographical area at any given time. And secondly, that the dental arcades, the teeth, and jaws would reflect whole body anatomy, determine niche adaptation, and thus prove to be adequate for defining species variability, and finally, that species are immutable. That is, that hybridization between species is both rare and inconsequential. All three of these hypotheses have largely been rejected by real discoveries, more complete specimens, and molecular biology. We'll examine some of these species questions in the future, but for now, let's look at one of the most difficult, Australopithecus africanus. We have reviewed in earlier programs the holotype of this species, the Taungchao, and we have looked a bit at species concepts, so let's take a look at the actual fossil sample and explore whether Australopithecus africanus, beyond the Taungchao, of course, is a cohesive species that can stand the scrutiny of a modern lens. We're going to look at three samples, Sterkfontein, Makapansgat, and to a lesser degree Gladysvale, as a sample from there is so small. Examining the morphology of these samples and attempt to decide, is the sample homogeneous enough? That is, it has a low enough variability to be considered a single species, or is the sample heterogeneous? That is, it exceeds an acceptable level of variation to be considered a single species. As we have seen, the original period of discovery of these fossils back in the early 20th century complexified the taxonomic understanding of that sample. They were originally put into three species and two genera, Australopithecus africanus, Plesianthropus transvaalensis, and Australopithecus prometheus. In the 1950s and 60s, these species were all rationalized into the single species, Australopithecus africanus, and this has become broadly paleoanthropological wisdom since then, despite there being the recognition of both significant cranial and postcranial variation in the samples from Sterkfontein, Makapansgat, and to a lesser extent Gladysvale. This is just not idle debate. Australopithecus africanus has played a critical role in understanding human evolution, and so whether there are multiple species or a single species is critically important to understand. Just open any scientific paper on early hominids if you don't believe that. And thus, whether there's one species within these samples, or two, or more is critical to almost every argument as to how, for example, either the genus Homo arose or the robust Australopithecines arose, or even other species, and whether or not the Southern African hominids play a significant role in the origin of later hominid taxa. So there's a lot at stake. The debates around the various arguments would take more than 20 lectures to go through, and in fact would probably come to unsatisfactory conclusions even after that. So I'm going to simplify the arguments of homogeneity and heterogeneity into some simple groupings. Let's call the first group the lumpers. In this group, scientists who examine the record suggest that while there is significant variation in Sterkfontein and Makapansgat, it can be accounted for either due to time, that is, the assemblage is time-averaging variation over hundreds of thousands of years of a single species, and thus producing a form of a chronospecies. And this time-averaging explains the variation we see. They would also perhaps point to sexual dimorphism as being the cause. That is, some of the fossil specimens are exhibiting male characters and some female characters, and this explains the variation we see. Some in this latter group would agree the sample is extremely variable, but africanus was simply as variable as the most variable species of living ape, like gorillas. And thus, such a species should be our model of variation. And when one uses such a living species as the model, the sample for africanus fits. Well, mostly. Others have taken a more unique play on lumping, arguing that we can use the most variable fossil species that most people agree on, like Paranthropus boisei or Australopithecus afarensis, which are pretty much more variable than gorilla variability, to establish that the level of variation in these samples is acceptable from Sterkfontein and Makapansgat. Of course, it broadly is, but I would suggest that this argument is circular, because there is at present no scientific way of testing whether these fossil species, afarensis and boisei, are real or just a manufacture of the same biases and inadequate samples that the one we are testing suffers from. Then there is the group I like to call the lumpers, but this group follows a similar logic to the lumpers, largely arguing the sample falls within acceptable variability of modern comparative forms, but there are a few specimens they would pull out as going too far in their variation. These would include fossils like STS-71, which many say is more Homo-like, STW-53, which some say is actually Homo habilis, and others argue is another species entirely. Or they would sample isolated postcranial remains, pointing to these as being clearly from two different adaptive forms. Scientists who fall into the category lumpers but look at the samples and suggest either there were more than one species running around in the hundreds of thousands of years that these sites likely sample, or that there are infrequent errors in stratigraphic association of certain fossils. That is, there is some unfortunate and unnoticed mixing due to the complexities of cave geology of some younger or older specimens, and this explains these aberrancies in the sample. As I discussed in an earlier lecture, this latter is extremely likely to have occurred given the complexity of cave fill formation. However, if true, it poses some unique problems as almost every scientist or group in the lumpers but category find different specimens that fall out based on whatever character or suite of characters they use. E.g., there's no real consistency which specimens should and which shouldn't be excluded. Then there are the splitters. These fall into two broad categories. Ones that see two groups and split the sample broadly into the prognathic or snouty specimens like Mrs. Plez and the orthognathic or more flat-faced like STS-52, STS-71. But these splitters tend to shy away from naming two species for some reason. And perhaps it's because of the implications of recognizing very Homo-like hominids within the particularly Sterkfontein assemblage, and what this might mean for the argument that Homo evolved rather in the Rift Valley further north. Or perhaps they are just being very conservative. Another group amongst the group splitters put most of the specimens from Sterkfontein into africanus, but then recognized there were specimens that were problematic, like STW-252, 183, 187, and 329. But they again didn't go so far as to name a new species. The more extreme amongst the splitters are those that argue there are definitively two species at both Sterkfontein and Makapansgat, where one is clearly the ancestor of Paranthropus and should be called Australopithecus prometheus, and the other Australopithecus africanus. Ron Clark has been the primary advocate of this, using initially the STW-252 specimen as the poster child for the more robust second species, and including in this specimens like STS-71, STS-36, and MLD-1 and 2. And in africanus, he would include, of course, Taung, STS-5, STS-17, STS-52, and MLD-6. The problem that I have with splitters, ultimately, is that they tend to just take two fossils and compare them and go, see, they're very, very different from each other, without doing any real metrical comparison to demonstrate the specific differences. Furthermore, among the splitters, there seems to be no consensus in where to put which specimens to form their favored species. Thus, this too is a problem. Finally, they're what I'll kindly call the chaos theory crowd. While in the minority, it's worth noting that they see upwards of a dozen or more distinct groups or species at these sites. This has been championed largely by people like Schwartz and Tattersall, and while a fringe idea, it gives one the idea of the observed variability many see in this sample. Another problem that all of these different approaches take is that africanus simply doesn't, as of yet, have an unequivocal skeleton, or preferably multiple skeletons that we could attribute to both males and females, that would allow us to look at whole body anatomy, and thus include postcranial variation in these studies. This time, such associations are really just assumptions based on the proximity of these finds to the craniodental remains. So what is the right answer? Is the broader use of Australopithecus africanus for the Sterkfontein, Makapansgat, and to a lesser extent Gladysvale samples justified? The answer is not simple. Each of the arguments above has merit. As I've noted in other lectures, the juvenile status of the Taung child complexifies matters when it comes to identifying just what is an africanus and what is not. But for the time being, let's just assume that the majority of the specimens at Sterkfontein have become africanus under common rules of Linnaean nomenclature. If so, which specimens should those be? In addition, none of these previous analyses that I've discussed have taken into account the possibility of hybridization. It just wasn't an idea in paleoanthropology to any significant degree at the time they were done. And that would certainly complexify the establishment of how many species there are if hybridization is occurring. You may be disappointed to find that I don't have a simple or clear answer for you. The extreme views, the lumpers, and the chaos theory views are likely incorrect, as they seem to both lack an acknowledgement of some basic biological realities of variation, but of course, that awaits testing. The field, I believe, in general, has resigned itself to this being an intractable question, until perhaps molecular biology comes to the rescue, hopefully in the not-so-distant future. Until then, it seems the field is accepted to either be in the lumper's butt category, and accept there will be some errors in variation, or in the moderate version of the splitters, where they will pick which specimens will be excluded from their comparisons based on favorite characters they feel hold stronger sway in their arguments about biological variation. Perhaps that isn't the answer you were looking for, an exact number of species that exist at Sterkfontein, Makapansgat, Taung, and Gladysvale. The answer is, we just don't know right now. There is hope on the horizon with molecular biology, proteomics, ancient DNA that might tell us eventually. There are advances in technology and comparative analyses that may assist us in establishing exactly how many species. For now, the answer is we just don't know. But don't despair. That problem isn't unique to the South African cave system, nor is it unique to Australopithecus africanus. It happens in East Africa too. We'll be looking at the problems with species like Australopithecus afarensis, Homo erectus, and Homo habilis in future lectures. For now, that's all from the University of the Witwatersrand Fossil Hominid Vault in Johannesburg, South Africa. I'm Lee Berger. You can follow me on Twitter at Lee R. Berger or like my public Facebook page, Prof. Lee R. Berger. Be safe out there. Keep washing those hands.